please. Mr. Smith, nice name.
Good morning, Your Honor. Abe Smith for appellant. May it please the court. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. For more than a decade, Chattem had H&H's trade secret technology for processing and extracting pure active pharmaceutical ingredients from raw opium and poppy straw concentrate.
Before you get to that, we sent out a focus order, and I would like you to address the second of these to start with, which is whether Nevada's Uniform Trade Secrets Act expressly displaces H&H's tort and restitutionary causes of action based on misappropriation of a trade secret. What's your answer to that?
Well, I think the answer is it has to be yes, that language comes from NRS 600A090 itself. I think the question is just how that applies in this case.
And in your view, how does it apply?
Well, first of all, I think Judge Navarro was clearly wrong in sua sponte deciding that a contractual that on the breach of contract claim, that the only way you could have damages for disgorgement was via a statutory remedy. I think she gets it exactly opposite. She said that there are no Uniform Trade Secret Act remedy damages if there's a contract, but it's actually just the opposite. If there's a contract that involves misappropriation, which is contemplated within the language of the Uniform Trade Secret Act, then the party's entitled to all of the remedies under that act for misappropriation.
So in this case, if you had your wishes, what would you have us do? Send it back to the district court to consider your claims under the UTSA?
Yes, and I think that would be fairly simple because you could do two things. One, on the contract claim, you could say either, I mean, there's actually a provision in the party settlement agreement, not the settlement agreement, but the NDA, that expressly provides for equitable remedies, such as the restitutionary remedy of disgorgement. But in addition, you've got the statute that provides, actually, I shouldn't say provides, it's always been the case, even at common law, before the enactment of the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, that if the contract or the claim involved misappropriation of trade secrets, that your remedy could include disgorgement of the other party's profits.
It seemed like the cleaner way is that your unjust enrichment claim is displaced by the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, that any remedy for unjust enrichment that's non-statutory at common law is displaced by the TSA and governed by the UTSA and therefore is an unjust enrichment claim under the UTSA and therefore is viable to that extent. Do you disagree with any of what I just said?
Only to the extent that obviously there is a contract between Chattem and H&H, and although we've cited the cases, we cited the restatement section that talks about the extraordinary remedy of disgorgement, yeah, I would agree that the unjust enrichment can be thought of as a restitutionary cause of action for which you would have the remedies under the Uniform Trade Secret Act.
So, counsel, if hypothetically we were to do that, but also hypothetically we were to say the district court was correct in her interpretation of what is available as a damage under Nevada's common law contract law, how would you be harmed? What would you
mean if we were allowed to proceed?
What would you lose if we sent the disgorgement back under the statute, but said the district court was correct in interpreting what you have to prove for damages under a common law contract claim and you didn't do it? Let's say, hypothetically, again, we affirmed that, but allowed you to try to get disgorgement under the statute. What would you be losing if we did that?
I'd say the only thing we'd be losing, I mean, obviously, each of these claims ultimately goes towards the same remedy. That's why, you know, when we disclose damages, they're all for the same remedy. What we're losing, obviously, is the chance to prove one or more claims, right? So if
but there is
if
the wouldn't jury, be a difference in like the scope of damages, a number of years or anything.
No, I think that would be the same.
So you're not disagreeing with what Judge Bennett just said then, right?
I don't think so, except that, you know, I'd prefer to go to the jury on multiple theories as opposed to being limited to one theory.
But you believe that under the UTSA, you can still do that?
Absolutely. Right, and that gets to our point about the claim having been pleaded in terms of the factual allegations. We cited the Velez case in our supplemental authority. Obviously, it's a matter of common knowledge that it's not the punctilious theory of pleading that matters. It's the factual allegations, and it's clear. Yeah, go ahead.
Even accepting that may be a correct statement of the law, what reason could you have had, or what reason did you have for not asserting an explicit claim under the statute, or making this argument explicit in your response to their motions?
Well, again, this wasn't an issue that came up in the briefing on the summary judgment, because nobody knew that Judge Navarro was going to take this footnote from an unpublished case and say your only way to get disgorgement is through a statute, when even Chattem and Son were agreeing that it was possible to get disgorgement. They just factually disputed that we had shown a causal link between their breach and their profits.
In your 2007 lawsuit against Chattem, you brought separate cause of action, and I'm going to quote here, for misappropriation of trade secrets, for misappropriation of confidential information, and misappropriation of commercial properties under Nevada law. You didn't allege those specifically in this lawsuit. Why is that?
Meaning we didn't cite the Uniform Trade Secret Act in the claims. Obviously, we did cite
right.
it in the factual allegations.
I mean, that specific language, though. I mean, that for the former causes of action.
I think it made total sense, because what we were doing was we were enforcing the provisions of the settlement agreement, mm-hmm. which, again, established that the NDA, the prior agreement from 2000, would remain, and this is from Section 6 of the settlement agreement at ER 387, that all provisions of the NDA shall remain in full force and effect, and it shall no manner other than respect to plaintiff's release be diminished. It then goes on to provide the requirement that, yeah, you can't use our confidential trade secret information. So it arises in the context of a contractual breach, even though the wrong that is committed through that contractual breach also states a claim for a misappropriation of trade secrets under NRS 600A. I don't think it makes any difference. In fact, as I said, under the statute itself, at 600A030, it talks about contractual breaches being the basis for misappropriation, just as in 600A090, it contemplates that a misappropriation of trade secrets claim could be based upon a contract. I think it's just talking about the remedy there. It's not requiring parties. Certainly, it's not a special pleading requirement.
What are you relying on when you say that it explicitly recognizes it can rest on a contract?
So the two places, 600A030, subsection 1E, talking about the definition of an improper means, which is one of the elements, willful breach or willful inducement of a breach of a duty imposed by common law, statute, contract, etc. So that would be one way that the trade secret claim could arise. And then again in 600A090, the displacement that you asked us to address, the displacement issue is specifically not displacing claims. In other words, it's not saying that if you plead a claim in unjust enrichment or for a common law claim of misappropriation of confidential information the way it was in the France versus Johnson case, it's not that the court's going to throw out your claim. It's just that your remedy is going to be dictated, perhaps circumscribed, or in the case of a contract, perhaps expanded by the availability of remedies under the Uniform Trade Secret Act.
What is your best argument that the district court erred in granting summary judgment to Chattem on your common law contract claims?
And just, I want to make sure I'm understanding your question correctly. Do you want me to address the damages issue, which was the basis for her decision?
She's specifically focused on common law contract claims. Is that all just subsumed now into the Uniform Trade Secrets Act issue?
Well, yes, to the extent that your common law contract claim arises, the breach of contract arises from a misappropriation of trade secret, mm-hmm. then I think the statute steps in just as it did in France. Mm-hmm. Again, the Nevada Supreme Court there, sua sponte, said, time out, there's a plain error here. Mm-hmm. Even though these claims were all pleaded as common law claims, we actually are going to impose the statutory scheme on top of that. So I do think that the statute subsumes those claims.
Right. So basically, from your perspective, those survive as part of the statute, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
And again, I think it's because it's a remedy issue,
right.
Not a pleading issue.
Right.
But let me address, and I think that answers your question on her error on what she relied on. Now, just briefly, since Chattem and Son alleged that they're, in any event, even if damages weren't the issue, that they would have prevailed on the merits of their breach of contract claim. There is a definitely dispute in the record as to the evidence, but we've submitted the report from Dr. Sturmitz. That's at ER 224, paragraph 8, talking about how Chattem relied and had to rely on H&H's confidential information to apply for and obtain the DEA licenses, including to import raw opium and to produce opiate products. Then Sun admitted that it had no independent process prior to its acquisition of Chattem. It had no DEA licenses, and so it was relying on what it got from Chattem.
What role, if any, does the district court's conclusion that there was no longer any confidential relationship play in our analysis of causes of action for a breach of that nature?
Yeah, and that was interesting because she got it right at the motion to dismiss stage where she did find that we had alleged a confidential, a special relationship, a confidential relationship. But then at the summary judgment stage, she said, oh, well, that isn't enough. But we did submit evidence. The evidence was in the settlement agreement itself. This is an unusual settlement agreement because it actually requires the contracting party, the party with our confidential information, to certify each year that we are not using your confidential information. It requires them to make specific statements to us. But there's no auditing mechanism. There's no independent way for us to verify it. We are solely and entirely reliant on the truthfulness of their statements,
so
which is what happened here.
The fact that you were, in effect, monitoring by virtue of the report what they were doing creates at least enough of a confidential relationship or certainly a trust relationship that it meets the requirements here.
Right. And as we point out in our brief, paragraph 17 of the settlement agreement does say except as set forth in this agreement, so that there is contemplating that things in the agreement could establish that relationship of trust. Unless you have any other questions.
You want to save some time?
I'd love to save the last 2 minutes. Thank you, Your Honor.
Please do. Very well. Okay, now we're going to hear from Mr. Weber.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the Court. Ethan Weber on behalf of Chattem Chemicals Incorporated and Sun Pharmaceutical Industries Incorporated. This Court should affirm the District Court's judgment for Chattem and Sun. H&H's appeal is an entirely attempts to make a disgorgement remedy work in as many ways as possible.
Let me ask you what I did your friend, starting off with the focus order. In your case, Ed, you... In terms of the diversity requirement, do you believe that the limited partnership, a limited liability company in this case, satisfies the requirements of diversity?
As far as diversity goes, yes, Your Honor. We do believe that H&H was complete. There was complete diversity at the time of removal.
Okay.
The testimony from both of the members of H&H at the time confirmed that they had lived in Nevada for some time.
They were just the two members, right?
That is my understanding, correct, Your Honor.
And with respect to the Uniform Trade Secrets Act, do you agree that that expressly displaces the tort and restitutionary causes of action based on misappropriation of trade secrets?
Yes, Your Honor, I believe that 600A 0.90 would displace the common law tort claims, but I think that it also just provides a separate grounds for dismissal of those claims in the first
although
instance.
Although it says it displaces the remedies, right?
Correct. So if it is going to the remedies issue, I think the separation between the breach of contract claim can live in conjunction with any, for lack of a better term, preempted common law claim. I think that the displacement theory there is would mean that those two could exist together. But I want to go back to a question that was first asked, what evidence there is to support the idea that Chattem was using H&H's confidential information. And the point that H&H refers to at a few places is the testimony from Dr. Sturmetz. But Dr. Sturmetz is relying on an inference that just because Chattem has an importing license for raw opium and raw poppy straw, that therefore they must be using H&H's process to process that material. And I want to step back because it's important to understand what Chattem does and doesn't do. Chattem uses alkaloids, thebaine, orapavine, and codeine, to produce active pharmaceutical ingredients. And H&H's chemical processes that Mr. Hack described at pages 167 through 169 describe a chemical process for converting raw poppy material into the alkaloids that Chattem uses. Those alkaloids that Chattem uses, it purchases on the open market. Jason Allen, who has been at Chattem since 1999, his declaration at SER 130 and 131 confirms that Chattem has never converted raw opiate material into alkaloids. And in fact, they purchase those alkaloids on the open market, and they always have. And as for the DEA licenses themselves, the settlement agreement specifically carves out that H&H has no interest in those DEA licenses or in their renewal. So, and on top of that, all of the DEA licenses were granted to Chattem & Son before this settlement agreement was signed. The last one that Dr. Sturmetz is referring to, the import license for raw opiate material, was granted in February of 2006. So all of those licenses predate the settlement agreement between the parties.
What the district court essentially relied upon in finding there was no confidential relationship?
Sorry?
Is that what the district court was relying upon when she determined that there was no confidential relationship?
Sure, Your Honor. The district court's reliance to determine there was no confidential relationship was the demarcation line of the settlement agreement. Is moving forward, the settlement agreement specifically says that it does not create any type of special or confidentiary or fiduciary relationship between the parties going forward.
So if the other side had explicitly alleged we are filing a claim under the Trade Secrets Act that involves a variety of remedies, it involves a variety of claims, but they breached a contract, they breached the statute, and we are entitled to disgorgement of profits, would the grounds that the district court relied on in granting your motion, that wouldn't work, right? There would perhaps have to be what you're talking about in the last couple of minutes, but what the district court ruled on would not serve to defeat that claim, right?
In that hypothetical scenario, yes, Your Honor.
Okay, so tell me why we shouldn't treat the complaint as alleging what I said and send it back to the district court to consider whether they can state a claim under the act, whether through contract or some other ground, but under the explicit terms of the displacement provisions of the act.
A few reasons, Your Honor. One, this court can affirm for any reason supported by the record. And to prove trade secret misappropriation under Nevada law, H&H would have to prove misappropriation of that trade secret. And before that, they would have to also prove trade secret. That's not something they set out to establish at summary judgment. It's not something that they ever argued below. In terms of the actual misappropriation, the record is clear
And H&H had a burden at summary judgment to come forward with some evidence that Chattem was using H&H's confidential material at any point, and they failed to do so other than pointing to Dr. Sturmetz's testimony. So this court has grounds supported by the record to affirm for Chattem and Son if it decides to treat the common law claims as displaced by the Trade Secrets Act. So while there may be some reason if that's the basis for the court's opinion, there's still grounds to affirm without a remand. And I do just want to clarify the entire lawsuit itself proceeded from the amended complaint, which merely changed one of the defendants, all the way through summary judgment as a breach of contract case. And the breach of contract that H&H alleged in its amended complaint and that it carried through its summary judgment were related to two specific provisions of the settlement agreement. One, that Chattem failed to provide the 5-year compliance and that it failed to provide adequate notice of the purchase by Sun. And at summary judgment, that was the kind of the realm of the world that the parties had litigated and argued for the better course of several years. So the trade secret misappropriation claim, while it may have been there may have been some issue with the displacement theory, there's nothing to support the fact that this was the theory all along, when in reality this really was a breach of contract case pointing to those two specific provisions. And in reply, at least H&H seems to move to this plain error argument, that it was a plain error for the district court not to kind of redraft or recast the complaint as one for trade secrets. But I think that the plain error is for blockbuster errors. It's not for taking the evidence that was before it and the arguments that the parties had made and trying to figure out what H&H must have meant all along. I think that the better course was exactly what the district court did, which was, here is the body of evidence. It doesn't have a sua sponte obligation under Rule 56 to go diving into the record to read every piece of evidence that might exist. It has that H&H, when faced with a motion for summary judgment, had an affirmative obligation to come forward with evidence that creates a genuine issue of material fact. And the key material fact that they are unable to controvert is that Chattem has never used H&H's processes, never did, and never has. And I think for those reasons, the trade secret issue can be disposed of either by this court affirming for any grounds that it sees supported by the record or by affirming the district court's judgment below. There are a handful of other points, too, getting back to the confidential fiduciary relationship kind of question. And there's a sense that there's some imbalance of power that might contribute to a fiduciary or confidential relationship that could support a constructive fraud theory. But I think that the cases we cite in the briefing and the other cases on that front, that requires a real imbalance of power, not something between two companies with sophisticated counsel who have had a long history of both a work history and a litigation history to go forward. And I do want to just mention briefly the restatement section, Section 39. And Section 39 is really just another way, again, to get at the remedies the only remedy that H&H put forward below, which was a disgorgement theory. Section 39 has not been adopted by Nevada, and the 11th Circuit and the 5th Circuit have both declined to adopt Section 39 as a disgorgement theory for breach of contract in Acrylicon and Hoffman, that said this is completely this does not align whatsoever with Georgia or Texas law on breach of contract, and Nevada law is no different than Texas or Georgia on that score. Just the last point that I wanted to raise in terms of diversity, just to make clear for the court, it's not in the excerpts of the record, but it is in the district court at ECF 16. Just to clarify, Chattem is a Delaware corporation organized under and headquartered in Tennessee, and Sun was at the time a Michigan corporation headquartered in New Jersey. That's at ECF 16. So with that, if the court doesn't have any other further questions, we'd stand on the briefing. And
very well. Other questions? I think not.
Thank you. I yield the rest of my time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. All right, Mr. Smith, you are the winding up for the day here.
And thank you for spending the week with us. let me address, unless I agree with counsel's statement about the diversity, I believe the parties are diverse and the record sites he cites are correct. Let me address the issue of plain error. Again, this is a situation where the district court sua sponte ruled on an issue that neither party had advanced and is, in fact, as conceded in their brief, incorrect, which is that the only way to get to a disgorgement remedy is through a statutory right. Again, the word disgorgement appears nowhere in Chapter 600A. They've acknowledged that the case we cite, Women's Federal Savings and Loan Act, that involved a breach of fiduciary duty claim, but regardless, not a statutory claim. It did allow for disgorgement. Let me address on the merits. Okay. Chattem claims that it was not using H&H's processes, but there's a conflict in the evidence about that. Mr. Bloom, the vice president of H&H, testifies at ER 61 and 70 in his application to the DEA that H&H has a very valuable and viable process, and they rely on that in their application. And then in the supplemental excerpts of record, the original excerpts of record at 539 through 40 and 571, they affirm that there are no changes to their technical advances even after the settlement agreement. Finally, for establishing trade secrets, they say, well, that was just alleged in the complaint, but it's nowhere proved. The party's NDA specifically sets out that the parties agree that these are trade secrets, that they're valuable information. And that's why the NDA specifically provides that money damages would not be a sufficient remedy, and that's why the contract provides for all other remedies available at law or in equity. For that reason, we ask that the court reverse. Thank you, Your Honor.
Very good. Thank you, gentlemen, for your argument. We appreciate it. The case of H&H Pharmaceuticals versus Chattem Chemicals is submitted, and the court stands adjourned for the week.
Session stands adjourned.